So really, in essence, healthcare informatics is really about IT and health. And it's about how we design systems, how we implement them, how we use them, what are the issues with them, where are the pitfalls, what are the research going on, all of that sort of stuff. But basically, it's all about the patient and the staff and the public, and how do we make information available that just, I suppose, assists the whole care process. As you know, if you have a particular condition, how you're managed through your hospital or your GP trip, and what does IT do to help in that regard? So if we look talk about hospitals, what will a digital hospital look like in 2025? Sorry, I'll just go back a second. This is a picture of the new children's hospital, and it's touted as being the first digital hospital in the country, but that's actually not true. There's quite a number of hospitals in the country that have it, and outpatient departments will look very different. Apologies, these are jumping ahead. I thought I'd turn that bit off, but I thought we might start with a little historical perspective on this, and where did we come from? Because it all didn't just happen, and we didn't just turn on. Bill Gates didn't rock up with full version of Windows and all the IT, and it all happened. It kind of has been a growing process, but a very slowly growing process. So, picture on the left, interesting looking ward, probably doesn't adhere to COVID separation standards. I really like the furniture in this one. So, we're a million miles away in that picture from an IT perspective. The picture on the right, I just thought it'd be interesting for those of you who are old enough to recognize what that is. Well, you're quite old, because it's my very first, it's the first computer I ever bought. And I had to go to Newry to buy it. It was awful piece of junk. But you know what? It kind of got quite a number of people interested in this whole area. So if we go back in time and go back to the 1980s, and what was it like in terms of medical records? That's kind of what we know. 40 years ago, we had some computer systems, mostly around patient administration and a bit of payroll. We had, in each department you went into, you might have had an IT system, but they certainly didn't talk to each other. We had different numbering. So, you went to one department, you had one particular number associated with your record. Go to a different department, totally different number. Loads of paper, no national number, but everywhere else was in an equally bad position. So we felt grand, like we were fine, and not, there wasn't much we could do about it. Jump forward to 2021, 40 years, loads of advance. Well, we have some health IT systems, but many hospitals and many, if you go to community care facilities, have little or nothing. It's really poor out there. Even in the 40 years that have happened, we still have departmental systems. They still don't talk to each other in many, many cases. We still have tons of paper. Data protection is there all the time. We're constantly worried about sharing data, and sometimes ridiculously worried about sharing data. We have a national patient identity number, but it's not rolled out everywhere, and it's not into systems. So we haven't really progressed in 40 years. We haven't done a huge amount. Now, on the right-hand side of the screen, you'll see three kind of acronyms. One is NIMIS, which is a National Imaging System, and it is there and it's working very well. The one below it is a system that's put in for maternal and newborn patients, and that's in four hospitals, and it's fully electronic and it works very, very well, but it's only in four, and there's another 12 or 13, I think, maternity units. And the one on the bottom is our national laboratory system, and that's been going for years and still hasn't gone live. So each of these kind of have different, I suppose, interesting lessons to be learned in all of them. And part of what we'll do in the course is try and explore some of those lessons and explore why did some systems get in, why do they work, and why are others being delayed? But we will talk a lot about paper. So what's wrong with paper charts? We've had them for hundreds of years. Well, what's wrong with them? Well, find yours in that if you're in there. That's half the problem. It's just everywhere. I mean, there is just paper everywhere. And the problem about paper is finding the information that you need, or your clinician needs, your nurse needs, or your doctor needs to treat you at a particular point in time, when it's buried in the mass. And you can imagine. And then the other thing is it degrades over time. Paper is not the greatest, And there was a hospital in London that was very close to the Thames, and apparently, if the Thames overflowed, the medical records department was underground and it got ruined. And there's not a lot you can do about it, so you lose data. So that's not a great place to be in. So paper has its advantages, but it has lots and lots of disadvantages. Could you imagine all these bits of paper should be filed away? But that's normal. That's what happens everywhere. So we really need an electronic system to try and get over this. This is an extract from a kind of a medication chart. I beg you to read any of them. Well, I can probably read one of them, the one in the middle there, Adalat, I think it is. And maybe the one above it is Perindopol. I don't know, but some of the others are just unreadable. So IT systems can help get over a lot of these, can stop many errors that are, you know, human errors that happen as a result of kind of just not having the data, poorly written data, wrong units, whatever the case may be. IT systems can help if they're implemented correctly. This was an interesting one. This is one particular hospital where they noticed this is a lift going into a lift that when they were bringing the patient to the theater, now and again, pieces of paper would drop down between the gap of the lift, part of their chart, and they'd have to go and find the bottom of the lift shaft to retrieve it. So you just never know where the paper might end up. And you know, that's just not going to happen in an IT world, really. So what can we do about it? We could stand on our hill and cry, or we just get on with it and try and solve the problem. And that's kind of what we're trying to do in the course. We're trying to, I suppose, expose people to the opportunities, the benefits of some of these systems, but also, you know, things that you really need to worry about. They're not all simple. They don't all just go in very easy. If they went in simply, we'd have them all done, and we haven't them all done. And it's quite, you know, health is very, very complex. It's not as easy as the politicians think and will tell you as it is. Half my job, or most of my job, is as Chief Information Officer in the Children's Health Ireland, and the other bit of my job is in UCD. And it's brilliant, the mix between the two, and you see the difference between the two, between the theoretical and the actual practice. And it's really good to, you know, in terms of getting the input from the class around their experiences and what happens and what they've seen out there. So how quickly is change happening? This is kind of an interesting graph. So, you know, how long it's taken kind of various technologies to get 50 million global users. In TV, it took it 14 years, but the iPad, 80 days. You know, so and I think newer technologies even quicker than that. I mean, I don't know what Snapchat took, or, you know, those sort of platforms. So things are happening very, very quickly, but it's not happening that quickly in health. So why is that? You know, what is the causes of that? Certainly electronic patient records will help. You know, and it's a big chunk of what we're trying to do. It is where we capture all or most of the patient information in an electronic format. We can interrogate it, we can access it, in many locations, all with the right kind of protections around that. The patient themselves can access it, you know, so we're starting to see kind of patient portals. You can get access to your chart or chunk of your chart on your mobile phone. And that's where we need to get to. We need to get to this idea of that's often touted in health, of this, the idea of a hospital without walls, you know, where health is really, it expands out from an environment and goes in right out into your GP, with your GP, your community care people, into your home. And this should be a seamless boundary, but we often think of it as being silos of work. You know, we go to our GP, we go to our hospital. Why is it that kind of bounded? We really, technology should help us break down those sort of boundaries. And that's, you know, electronic patient records will help hugely in that. But there's things you need to really consider when putting these in. How do we implement these necessary systems? You could take the following approach. You could take the Ryanair approach and say, well, this is it. That's what you're using. Get on with it. And, you know, if you don't like it, go somewhere else. And that's one way around it. And there might be some merit in that. But what we would do is, certainly what we do in the course, is we try and talk about why that mightn't always be the right thing to do. It might work if you're a commercial organization just doing one thing, which is effectively selling airline tickets and all the other bits that you might buy as part of that airline flight. But health is really complex, and it's all the different interactions. And it's not just one thing that you get done. You don't just go in to get your heart transplant, because you have everything else that's going on before that and after that, and longitudinal care, and it just extends in all sorts of boundaries. So you really have to be mindful when we're implementing these systems that it's not just a very simple task, and it's not just a point type solution. They are quite complex over time. We'll talk a little bit about apps and mobile apps, and they're always being touted, and there's hundreds, thousands of companies who will walk into your hospital or your clinic and say, I have the best app. It's going to solve everything for you. It does everything. And they don't. You know, they often are not connected to anything else, and they might capture a bit of data, but they don't. That data goes nowhere. So what use is it really? You know, how do you see it somewhere else? So we will talk a little bit about, mobile apps and the good points about them and the negative points about them. And if we capture all this information electronically, what are we going to do with it? You know, so it's there's tons of it out there. At the moment, it's quite hard for us to get actual data. But if you've downloaded the COVID app, you'll see some of that data. You know, it's small amounts of data. There's an initiative by the government around open data and trying to make this data much more accessible. And you can go and have a look at that if you're interested. And we'll talk a bit about that as well in the course. And just generally trying to make things much more transparent to the patient. And that's this whole change in culture. It's not just about the technology to make this stuff available. And here's just some interesting data, and you kind of look at this. This is from a number of years ago from St. James's Hospital. I think it was where CT, so when they get a request to do a CT, where does that patient come from based on their address? And James's is the little one dot right in the middle there. That's James's. So you can see you get patients from all over the place. And you wonder, well, why is there no one here? And it turns out, well, that's an industrial estate, so that kind of makes sense. But then you look at it nationally and you see, oh my God, there's patients from up here in Donegal and Letterkenny and places like that, and you know, over in Limerick. Why are they coming to James's when they could equally get a CT done in Letterkenny or somewhere like that? And then we just look at that information. So it the data poses all these sort of questions. And you know, are we unnecessarily asking our patients to travel all the way down from Letterkenny to get a CT when they probably could have had it done locally? So maybe not in all cases. There might be particular tests that are done in Dublin that they can't do in Letterkenny, but in the main, we should be trying to make all this much easier for patients, and we'll talk about that. And the growth of data is huge in healthcare. Healthcare is swamping nearly everything else. And as we get more and more electronic systems, we're going to get more and more of it. And what do we do with it? We can start to use things like artificial intelligence to help us look at this sort of data. And this is just some examples around where there's some successful work going on around using AI in radiology and in the interpretation of certain abnormalities in chest X-ray. And certainly there's definitely benefits in there. And don't think that the radiologists themselves are getting worried about this. They're not, because there's not enough radiologists. They can't get enough, and they can't get enough pathologists either to look at kind of pathology slides, histopathology slides. So AI and those sorts of tools definitely have a place and a growing place in the care of healthcare. In oncology, Watson, IBM's Watson, is an AI tool very developed and very much in oncology, and helps to kind of manage patients in oncology, but in specific areas. So we'll learn a little bit about that in terms of where they play a role and where they don't play a role. It's also important to understand that where they can't and that they don't work so well. So with all this data, how do we know we're keeping it safe? And that's kind of really important. So it's great sharing the data and that people can see it, but are we doing it in a right way? So we will talk about that in the course as well. And we'll talk about kind of things, a broad area of information governance. And I just pose this question, you might think about it yourself, and I'm not going to give you the answer, because actually in a lot of cases, there's no right or wrong answer. Doctors taking pictures of skin conditions or x-rays on their own mobile phones, a good or a bad thing? What do you think? And you know, it's an interesting question to have a discussion about, and there's pros and cons in both of it. Or what about a patient accessing all of their electronic records from home? A good or a bad thing? Yeah, you'd probably say good initially, and then we'll discuss, and we often discuss kind of where maybe it's not so good to access all of their records at all of the time. So there are pros and cons. Sharing data between hospitals, I think in the main people would say yes, we should do that if a patient moves from hospital to hospital. But there might be cases where that's not the right thing to do, and we'll talk a little bit about that. So we'll also talk about how do we measure our progress. So we're going to, if the government gives us lots of money and we're going to invest and we're going to make huge headway, how do we know we're doing things well? Well, there are international scales of how we measure our progress, and one is this from the HIMSS organization. We'll talk a little bit about that, and there's some lectures on this and what are called adoption models. This is where, when I was in James's, this was where we measured ourselves at, and a couple of years ago, here's where most people want to be at stage six or stage seven. So we've a good bit to go, you know, and I think in the country at the moment, there's only one stage six hospital, and that's the Galway Clinic. It's a private hospital. But we the CIO from there gives some lectures on this and what this looks like. So we'll also talk about what's happening in Ireland. And in many cases, we get people who are very closely involved with some of these projects to come and actually lecture on the course. And they give it to you really firsthand in terms of what's really happening and where the progress that's been made is really happening. And all of this is kind of in the background. There's this thing called eHealth Ireland, and the HSE are really trying to drive this agenda forward to try and improve things. And even the European Investment Bank gave us a loan a couple of years ago of 225 million. I don't have any of that. I don't know where it is, but it's there somewhere to try and drive forward an investment. But the investment is big. Don't underestimate it. It is big. So it would take, to get electronic patient records into every hospital in the country, would take about €1 billion. And you think, oh my God, €1 billion. But then we're spending €3 billion on the internet or the national broadband. So where's the balance? So we chat about those sort of things as well. We do talk about, as I said, the national electronic health record, and there are various elements to that, and we'll go through each of those. But really what we're trying to do is look at the changing face of digital health and areas where digital can kind of really start to make an impact on how we deliver care. Right from on the left-hand side, a patient who's out, you know, not at home, but mobile, right through their own home, right through the working environment, into the hospital, tertiary care and quaternary care, and all the way back down again. So what's the answer to all these questions? Well, I'm not going to give you every answer, but the course certainly tries to address that. And we've split the course into kind of three broad blocks that build on each other. So the first is really a graduate certificate in healthcare informatics, 30 ECTA credits. And you do kind of three core modules that you can see there: clinical information systems, biostats and data management, and medical records. And then you pick one of the following three of those options there: data programming, medical devices, or essential Python for life sciences. So that's the first block. Most people go on then and are more interested in the diploma in healthcare, which you add on to that. So it's in total 60 credits. So you add another 30. You have two core modules in the second. Trimester. So that's interoperability and information governance. There are five. And then you take 2 to 4 modules totaling another 20 credits. And there's quite a long list of options there that you can take. And some of them run in spring and some of them run in summer. So you can spread it out over the year, depending on your working environment or depending on where are you full-time or part-time. And then for some candidates, they want to actually go and do an MSc in healthcare. So they want to build on the grad diploma, and that's 90 credits. So effectively you have to add to what you've done for the diploma and the cert with a dissertation and a research project that's to the value of about 30 credits. So that's kind of how you build up to it. Duration, normally the cert is typically September to December, one trimester. Grad diploma typically runs over the year, but you could do it in two trimesters if you took all the particular options that run in spring. The MSc is definitely over a year, but depending if you're doing it part-time, you might run the project in the second year, so it could be 24 months. So it's a mix between full-time and part-time. And our next intake is September. Who should take the course? Most of the people taking the course are people who are working in health, doctors, nurses, physios, whatever the case may be, IT, clinical engineers, who are interested in learning more about the role of IT in healthcare and the role of IT systems and data systems in healthcare. We get some IT people who are interested in, they might be working in healthcare but don't know enough about what goes on in healthcare, so they also will take it. And then there are people who are generally outside it who are just kind of interested in getting into this or all areas. So it's a broad mix of people. Eligibility, typically people would have, you know, a degree coming into it. You may not, and if you've many years experience, we can often take that into consideration. You know, if you've been working in health environment and you know well what's going on, we can often take that.